My name is Robert John Langdon, and you're watching my video channel. This video cast is one of my 10-minute shorts, which looks at sites around Britain using LiDAR. In a strange sense, this is my version of landscape archaeology for the 21st century. I hope you enjoy. Last week we looked at phase one of Avebury site, which was Windmill Hill, which we discovered was an island in the Mesolithic. This week we'll look at the main site, Avebury, to see how that developed and why. The first thing we need to do is have a look at how Avebury looked in the Mesolithic, and here we are back again with the Mesolithic high waters. This is the Kennet. This is Windmill Hill, and as we saw last week, Windmill Hill, a caused wade enclosure, or what I call concentric circle site, which is much more accurate, which is actually orientated towards the water, so boats would come in and could moor around the edge. Now, as the Mesolithic continued and the rivers fell in height, what would have happened? This site would have become more and more inaccessible. So much so that at some point they would have to actually have a new site, and this is where Avebury, or phase two as I call it, was built. If we zoom in a bit into Avebury, you can see it's quite unique with its large ditches and the River Kennet actually flowing. But this is the River Kennet here today, very small, obviously much larger in the past. When it was that size and that large, and I'll show you a picture in a tick of the alluvium from the British Geological Association that they've found around here, it shows that once upon a time the Kennet was this size and would have touched the edge of the Avebury site, which gives you a bit of a clue of what they were doing with it, because the boats will now be able to come in and moor inside Avebury in these gigantic ditches, which I would imagine actually were joined. We now got roads there. This would have just been one large ditch. I think there would have been a gap here, because we've got the stone avenues coming out this side, but I would imagine the ditches would have continued here and would continued on that side as well. And it's only recently, since the roads have been put in, that these ditches have been filled in, for obvious reason. Now, what's interesting, if we can pan in and tilt this just a little bit, is having a look at the west side, which has been lowered for the Kennet. Now, archaeologists have seemed to have missed this completely for some reason. As we can see there very clearly, and what I'll do, I'll take the water off because it's a bit distracting. This is better. What you can see here very clearly is that this bank has been tapered. It's been rounded here and tapered there. Now, that, and obviously on this side, it's been tapered here. There is no logical reason that should have been tapered. And if you look at some of the archaeological drawings, they will show you it has been completely round at some point, which is a nonsense. It was never that way. These tapered edges have always been there, and as we have a closer look, we could go around the back and have a look. We can show you that basic. There you go. Can't get more clear than that. This was made to be tapered. This was not natural. There is nothing here. Most people think that it was tapered or cut down because it's in a way off part of the town. Well, there's no town there, and as you see from the LiDAR map, there's never been, We see walls and buildings and bits here and here and here, but here, nothing. So why would you take down this gigantic bank if you have no reason to? It's a bit of a nonsense, really. So this tapered effect of the bank has never been explained by archaeologists, unfortunately. But it is a main key feature, and if we put the water back in again, it becomes painfully obvious, and that's a bit too high, and it will drop a bit. Here we go. Painfully obvious that this is where the water would come in to fill the ditches of Avebury. Archaeological Conundrum 101, Avebury resolved. Okay, if we go and take a look at the other bank here, we also see that it's rounded off, it's not square, it's been tapered as well. And that's because it was never meant to be there. And I imagine once upon a time that the River Avon probably came in here and would have come in here. It'd be very hard to see this now because this is now raised ground due to the fact that you've got a cricket ground and you've got buildings, and you can see this is natural ground. This has been built upon in recent years with bits and pieces which have changed the level, and therefore we don't see, as we'd see on this side, this nice clear aspect of where the river would have come in the past. We can see it here, very clear, river would have been here, boats would have come here, and trading would have been on here, very much like Windmill Hill in the past. So that's a very clear indication of Avebury phase two. The other aspect which archaeologists sadly don't really go into much detail about is why the ditches are so deep. Don't need to be 12 meters deep, do they? Unless there's a really good reason. Now, sadly, I watched a Carenza in Time Team once, and he told me on the television that these ditches were so deep it was to keep out evil spirits. Wow. How can I question that? That is such a scientific proof with such great evidence. Who am I to question that logical scientific conclusion to why these ditches are 12 meters deep? Unless, of course, it's wrong. What we have found is that as the river, and let's see if I can illustrate this by just dropping the river, as the river went further and further away, the water table would have got lower and lower, as you see here. It's dropped another 3 meters. If it drops another 3 meters here and not touching, to keep this as water, and I would imagine, again, because we can't see it, there might be still a connection roughly here to here, because again, you've got buildings here, it's ruined the landscape, so it's almost impossible to tell original surface area was. It's all been built up since then, but clearly from this illustration here we can see there is a hint that the river continued to touch the edge of the site here, and it's dropped from 157 to 154, so that's 3 meters. Now if it's dropped 3 meters in water level, these would have to be 3 meters deeper to contain the water. That's the logical aspect of the water table. So let's say it started up as a 2 meter ditch, which is what we see in Stonehenge and other sites. Started up as a 2 meter ditch with water. As it started to dry up, they would have to then dig. So it would, on this occasion, they would have to add another 3 meters to it. So that's a minimum of 5 meters, which is a very, very big ditch. So what we see here is that Avebury was actually built in stages. And then we see this later on phase three, when we start looking at Silbury Hill and the fire beacon there. And how that was built, we see it started low and it built up high over hundreds of years. very good reason for that is for visibility. On this occasion with Avebury phase 2, it's because the groundwater dropped and they tried to keep up with the drop of the groundwater by digging the ditch deeper until it got to 12 meters. And if I can just lobby in a picture here, when we done an excavation, or when archaeologists done an excavation in 1922, when they got to the bottom of this ditch, which was at the same height as the cross, so you can see the picture, would have been at the same height of as the Kennet, which is this river here. They actually had to stop because it filled full of water. One would might have to say, bit of a clue what it was when it filled full of water, but clearly archaeologists don't want to know the truth because they'll have to rewrite the books. Anyway, that is Avebury phase 2. Next week we'll look at Avebury phase 3, which will be looking at the very famous Silbury Hill and why that was built. And again, that's to do with water levels. Well, that's all we've got time for this week. Tune in next week for another edition of Langdon Investigates, where we look at another ancient site. Until then, subscribe below to make sure you're informed when new videos come on the video channel. Until then, thank you for watching.